So I'll be talking on Django and Django REST APIs. So yesterday all the projects were based on what type of projects do we have here, what is Sunbird, what is collaborative community. So today we'll be talking everything technical. You will see no lines of, everything will be coding here. So that's why I want you to all guys to come in front and see so you can see the codes. And so how many of you know Django here? No one. So how many of you know Python? How many of you know object-oriented Python? How many of you have done more than 200 lines of code in Python? So what is Django? It's basically a framework. So there is built-in features like what is ORM, and then there is a template engine, there is a form engine. So you have to basically focus on the code. You don't have to worry about what is how to handle the query sets, how to handle the connection between the MySQL and other things, like how to do catchings and all. Those will be done internally by Django. So you have to just focus on how to code and write your business logics in Django itself. So these are the things like ORM. So any of you know what is ORM here? Yes. So object relational mapping is just it is basically everything is objects here. So all the database resources will be converted into Python objects. Even in Java also there are ORMs available. So every framework just follows the ORM. So if you are working on Django, you have to understand what is ORMs, what is object relational mapping, what are models, what are views, what are templates. So it's basically a model, view, template. These are the three things in Django. What is a model, what's a view, and what's a template. So model is ORM, it's the database. It talks with your database. It database can be any database. You can take MongoDB, Cassandra. I think they don't provide connection for Cassandra, but they provide for MongoDB, Postgres, MySQL. Okay. So even you have written a lot of code in ORM and you want to change your database, you don't have to worry. You just have to change the in your settings files. You have to map. You have to say what kind of database you are using. So you know what is the difference between MVC and MVT? You have heard MVC? So there is Laravel, Codeignator. These are all MVC frameworks. But this Django is a MVT framework. There is no difference. Just they have changed the name. This view is actually a controller. It is actually a controller and this is the view. But they have changed the name. They have called it MVT. You will write all your templates in all your template processing in HTML files, all your controllers in view files, all your models in model file. So we'll see now in details what's the model. So what is the execution flow? So this is the execution of entire Django. So when you make a call to an URL, any URL which is there in the system that you have programmed, so all these URLs will be mapped to a functions. This function can be a class-based function, it can be entirely a class, or it can be a user-defined function. So all your URLs will be defined in urls.py file. It will map to your view functions, where you will write your actual business logics. So these view functions will call all the models and will render to a template. So these are all, you have to write all your business logics in view functions. So it can be class based functions or user defined functions, or you have to do some inheritance from all the Django functions that are defined there. So those who have done some thing in Django, they might know what is this. So to create a project, you have to do Django admin start project summer internship. So this is the project we will do today, and we will see how to create interns. We'll fetch some interns, like we'll do some three operations, crude operations. We'll create some interns, we'll fetch some interns, we'll fetch an individual intern, we'll update an individual intern through Django models and through REST APIs, which we'll talk later. So when you will create a project, it will create basically these things. It will create your main repository, and then there will be a sub repository where there will be settings files and URLs files. These two files you have to just concentrate. Other files, these are admin files, you have just for starting the projects to take a backup or other things. In your settings files, you will define your database settings. your catchy settings, your REST API settings, every settings related to Django will be defined in setting files. And all your URLs, all your routers will be defined in URL files. So whatever functions you will write will have to map to a URL. So those URLs will be defined in URL files. And this is used when we'll VCVG is used when we will launch our Django in production server. When we will launch in Django or Apache. Now Django provides a development servers internally, so you can do Django managed by run server. It just gives you a temporary server to do your development code. So when you start doing a project, you may divide your project into submodules. So if you do summer internship, there will be an institute module, there will be an intern module, there will be teachers module, there will be projects module. You want to divide your projects into submodules. You don't want to write all your code in one place, right? So you will start creating apps. So to start an app, you have to do Python 3 managed by start app, your app name. So we'll be creating intern app here. So as soon as you create an app, it will create a folder. So this is the folder it will create. So every app will have a model file. A view file, can you see it? A view file, a test file where you will write your unit test cases, and then an admin file. So Django provides an admin section where you can handle all your all the models you can view in your admin related front ends. In models file, you will write your models, your ORMs. So every class is a table in your database. Whatever database doesn't matter. So every class will create a table in your database. Every field will create an attribute. We'll create a column in your database. So in case of interns, we are taking three fields, name or four fields, name, address, created at, and institute name. Okay, these are the models. After creating your models, you do Python 3 managed by make migrations. Why you do make migrations? So that Django can keep track of what are the fields that you have created here. In migration sections, they will keep track of all the models that you have created. And after that, you do Python 3 managed by migrate. And that will create all the database, all the models to your database. You create all the tables, all the fields, you don't have to worry about anything. So when you work with models, you don't go to MySQL and change anything, or go to MongoDB or change any field, because all those changes will be kept tracked on migration sections. You don't change internally. So those were models. So after you have created your models, you need to import in your business logics. Now you will write your business logics, what you want to do with your models. So I want to fetch all the interns. All the interns, suppose there are interns in the database, I want to fetch all the interns. I will write def, this is a Python function, okay? So I'll get all the interns. This is the models, interns, objects, all. I'll get all the models, I will put it in a variable, and I will render with the request. I'll render a Python dictionary. You know what is a Python dictionary? I'll take all the interns, I'll render to intern.html, and now the intern.html will have all the values in the Python dictionary. Now this is a view function. This is just a very basic function. It is not a class based function. It's just a simple function. It takes all the interns and display it in the interns.html. So every view functions accepts a HTTP request and gives an HTTP response. That's why you have to, in every functions you have to give request. So it accepts HTTP request and gives an HTTP response. So the function basically takes interns, objects, all. You are taking all the interns in a variable. So it's a dictionary now. Now when it renders the interns equal to interns. So it's taking all the interns and sending the interns, this is a variable here, and sending all the interns to a dictionary. This is entirely a dictionary. Now in your templates, you will have a dictionary as an interns. So I will show you how to display it in the templates. So this is the flow you need to do. You need to first create your models, then you need to define your views, then you need to map it to a URL. So after you have written a class or a function, you have to map it to a URL. So this is a regex, a regular expression. So it is a URL name, the view functions that you have written, and you have given a name to a URL. and you are importing your views here. So from interns I'm importing the view file. So after that, in the view file I'll be having all my functions. So views dot all interns. So our function name is all intern details. So it is mapped to a particular URL. So when you call this URL, it will display, give you all the interns in the interns.html file. So every URL that you will call to this server will be searched in URL patterns. If a URL is not available in URL patterns, it will just give you an 404. That is, the URL is not available. So this is how we will display it in interns.html file. So this is a template language, Django template language. There are other languages available called Jinja or something else. So Django has a built-in language called Django template language. So this is the syntax. Every conditional syntax will have a percentage sign, bracket and a percentage sign. Every variable will have double bracket sign. So you see how now the interns variable will be available in interns.html because the function is sending. Because the function is sending the variable to the template. The intern.html template will have the interns variable. Now we have to look through it. Because it's a dictionary function, it will have lot of values. So we'll write a for loop. This is how we'll write a for loop. So we'll loop through the intern variable, and each intern will have a name because it's an ORM. Each intern will have a name, an address, an institute, and this is how you can display with HTML tags. We'll give some HTML tags. It can be a table, it can be a list. So this is MVT. Now you can write class-based functions. What kind of functions you want? If you can understand this one, this thing, this many things, these three things: model, and then views, URLs, and templates. These are the four things you need to know in Django. Now in the previous function we are fetching all the interns. Now we want to get only one intern, not all the interns. We have to write a different business logic or different function for that, right? So basically we have to give a parameter to the function which is accepting the, so we have to give the intern ID, or it's a primary key, PK. So you have to give the intern ID. You see, after request there is a PK. So this function will accept a request and as well as a parameter. Then you will get from interns objects get that particular intern with PK equal to PK, right? So PK equal to PK, and it will give you only one intern with that ID. And after that you render the intern to another profile which can be intern.profile.html. How PK is defined? How PK is defined in the one more thing. So in ORMs, if you have not defined explicitly that you want a primary key, it will create a primary key internally for every model. If now you have created name, address, created institute, so it will create a primary key internally if you have not defined. So if you will define explicitly, for you want your phone number to be a primary key, so you give models dot auto field and you set primary key equal to true. There's lots of function available in models. And similarly, models dot foreign key, you will call other models and will map to those models. Okay, so this function is taking an ID and staking the intern and sending it to intern.profile.html. Now see the URL here. Now we'll definitely write a different URL for different functions. So this intern.profile.url, this is a regular expression it is taking in the URL and it's mapping to intern.profile. You have to give a name to a URL. So this is a regular expression. So this is it's taking a primary key. It can be 1, it can be 100. So this is the format of the regular expression. There are many other regular expressions available. For example, there is a slug regular expression available. So if you want to send a name, a alphanumeric name to a URL, you want to have a different names with the, it can be an art, if you want to see an article, you want to give the name of the article, so you have to give slug here. So this intern profile, the regular expression, and the function will check the URL and find out what field it has. So this PK has to match with this field. And similarly, in the template file, you have to display it. Since you will have one field only, so you don't have to loop it: intern name, address, institute. So those were basic Django. Now we'll see what is Form API. So now we'll create some intents, and we can use HTML tags. We can use, and there are some other internal Django Form API and Model Form API available, which we'll see. Can you see it? So there are basically three fields: the intern name, address, and the institute name, which will be given as input by the user. And this is the function we'll write for that to create a intern. So the create intern takes three fields. So HTTP post dot post, HTTP dot get, or HTTP has a lot of other fields. Like this request, this HTTP request variable I'm talking about. This request variable have lot of other fields. You will get, if you send anything to get, you will get request dot get. So you will basically get three fields. From those three fields, you take those fields. So intern objects create, it will create the intern. Okay, so we'll create the intern. So after creating the intern, you want to view it into a profile or some other. So you'll return redirect. So redirect function takes another function and sends it to the, and give you a parameter here, and it's render it to another function. So any confusion? If redirect function till here. So how is intern getting created? So it's taking three variables, creating the intern. So redirect functions calls other functions. This is another function which you have already created previously. It's calling the other function, and that function needs a parameter, which is a PK. It's a primary key. It takes the intern. After creating the intern will have this intern. It creates the intern as well as it sends the object that has been created in this variable. So it will take the variable and gives the ID to the function. So every functions you create, every form you create, you have to give the CSRF token. So why? Do you know what is CSRF? It's cross-site request forgery attacks. There are many kinds of attacks available. So Django keeps you safe from all this. You have to just write CSRF token. So if in any websites you see, for example, in WordPress, there is a CK editor available. If you embed some JavaScript code or form codes, it gives you alert. It gives you some kinds of, you can literally attack the site using some JavaScript code or some kinds of code. But Django, it protects you from all this. Just you have to give the CSRF token. The CSRF token generates a hash code, which is 126, I think, or 256. So it hash code, it is generated every request. Every request, there it is a different CSRF code, CSRF token. So in every form, you have to just write CSRF token defined inside the form. So this will redirect and then it will render. And for create intern, I'm not showing you the URL. You definitely know how to map it to a URL. So this is that was how you can create a form using HTML. Now we'll create some form using built-in Django features. And that is, one is forms.form and one is form.form model. So this is form API. It will match the number of fields with the models. Number of fields in the models, you have to create the same number of fields in your forms. You definitely don't have to create the created by field, because that will be created internally by the models itself. It will take the machine time and machine. So name, address, institute. This is the forms API. It extends the form, forms.form. So this is the form API. Similarly, the same code previously we have written, create intern. So the what does the form API gives? It gives built-in validations. So this form.clean data, name, address, you see these three fields. It checks whether it is an integer field, whether it's a character field, whether it's a Boolean field. It checks all that. It matches with the models and gives you the value. It gives you the built-in validation. So if form is valid, so when you send a form, when you send through a request post request, if the method is post, so you have to create the form using this request.post field, because there will be three fields and it will create internally using the form. These three fields will be available, will create the intern, and the other things are just the same. This is form API. There is no difference between that, but just will get a built-in validation. So did see the difference? You don't have to write the HTML codes here. Don't have to write any fields. You have to just give the form dot s paragraph. So there are other tags, form dot s table. You just give the CSRF token, because the form has all the fields. The number of field you will define here. There are three fields, so it will create three fields for you with the level. Sorry, with the level as name, level as address, level as institute. So you just have to write form as paragraph. Got it? Pretty easy, right? No one is asking any questions. So that was form. Now we'll see what is model form. So this is less number of code again. So you don't have to create the form at all. You'll just map it to which model it is. Say what model you are taking. You are taking the intern model, and you want to say how many fields you want to display. You'll give the number of fields, and it will display in the HTML page. You'll just have to map to model forms. When you create the form API, this is a model form API. You'll say which form it is, and the number of fields, and it will display form as paragraph. This is a model form. So in model forms, also you have to write very less number of codes. You have to just check if the form is valid and form save. You don't know what is happening internally. It's happening internally. The form API is handling everything. So basically, if the request is post, it's taking all the variable from the post and it's creating the form. It's checking if the form is valid. It's saving the form. After saving the form, it gives you that object that is being created. And you call redirect functions, which is another function. Or if the request is not post, you create the form, send it to the create HTML, and give the form variable there. So it will render in the template. What is the benefit of one over the other? See, when you have a team is very small, you have two people to work for. You want less number of codes to write. So definitely the development process becomes faster. If you want to write HTML, you can write HTML. And obviously you get the built-in validations. You don't have to check whether it is SQL injection or other kind of attacks are there. So this form is valid, will check everything. Checks the what is the type of field you are sending. If you in integer field you are sending some query text, some SQL query you have sent in the integer field. So it will check everything. If it is valid, then only it will save. Otherwise, it will give you the form. So the benefit is, obviously you can work hard, you write all your codes, or you can take the benefit of form API. You can always, so only thing is that it is happening internally, you need to understand it. So till now we are writing all function based view, now we'll write some class based views. So there are two types of class based views, one is class based and one is generic class based views. So in class based views, you don't have to do the conditional check if the method is post or if the method is get. You have to just give the HTTP method name. So you know what are the HTTP methods, status codes, and what are the status codes, you know, 404, 200, okay, those kind of the status codes. So in a class, these are the functions, these are the methods you need to write, and it has to match with the HTTP methods. So the rest of the thing are just same. This get will give you, just when you make a get request to this class, you will come to this get function, will make a post request, will come to the post function, and you write your post logic in the post function, you'll write your get logic in the get function. There will be other functions you can add, like delete function, update function. Those function name are similar to HTTP methods name, and you have to write it in the, it extends the Django views generic class. So it has built in class function, built-in methods. You can also override those function. You can define other functions here, which are there in the view classes. Then those you can see from the documentation, obviously. So basically, you have to give the name of the functions. See, there are other functions available. Render function you can write. You can write the in the post function you can define the render function. And after the get is done, you call the render function. After the post is done, you can call the render function. So when you map a URL to a class, you have to give as class name as view. So when you map it to a function, you just write view in the function name. So when you map it to a class, just have to give the views class name as view, and you definitely have to give the name, because the URL template text will search with the name, not with this. That was class based view. In class based views, you just have to give the function's name what are available in HTTP methods. So what is generic class based views? It is just like what we have done in model forms. In model forms, we have just mapped it directly to the model. In generic class based views, these are the classes available and it will map directly to the models. So what is happening internally will not get anything. So this will give you the list of interns. So when you write a generic class based view, GCBV, so you extend that class, write which model it is. It's a context object name. So what is a context object name? So when it will does all the get, post, everything internally, because it's extending the list view. So in the template intern.html, the interns will be available in the form of interns. So that's why you have to give the context object name as interns. Take a time to, if you're not getting any question. You don't have to write any post, any get. Obviously, the post is not allowed in this because it's a list function, list view. It's a get method is allowed here. Post method is not allowed because you will obviously want some interns. So that's why you're using list view, right? So it will say that which model it is. It's an intern model, okay. Then what is the class? You will see the list view. It will get all the interns internally. So which variable, what is the variable name you want in that template? You say this intern, and then it will render directly to the template. This is list view. Let's see how you can create an intern using the generic class based views. You see very less number of code. You don't have to write any post function, any get function. You just have to say which, and also what method is allowed here. The post method is allowed here because it's a create view. So you say which model it is. You say intern model. You also have to define the form class, this new intern, which is a form API, because you want a form in the HTML. So this is a new intern form which you have already defined before. This is a model form, and you give the template name. So after the intern has been created, so you just, what is the success URL? So see, I don't want you to understand this now because everything is happening internally. So if you understand the basic function, it's good, but just think that something called generic class based view is there. So tomorrow you go and see what is it. If you can understand it, is very good, because everything is happening internally. Don't have to do, just have to write 4 lines of code and your intern is created. Before, in the class, you have to write 15 to 20 lines of code for that. So you just have to define the model name, form class, template. So what's a detail view? So detail view, if you want to see a particular instant of that, in last view was giving the list of interns and you want to get only one intern, right? You say similarly the model name, the template name, the context object. It will take the value that will send in the URL, fetch the value. The class will fetch the primary key from the URL and return that single object. So this is detail view. There are other update view is available and lot of other views are available. So that was GCV. I don't want to go more in details. If you have any question, you can ask me. So So if you can understand just URLs, templates and views, that's fine. If you can understand class based views, that's great. If you can understand generic class based views, then you have to do in very less number of code, you can write a lot of things. So you like only machine learning? So how many of you know machine learning here? Only supervised learning or unsupervised learning? What kind of learning? All the models? Unsupervised also? Great, great. How many projects have you done in machine learning? 3 projects. Good. You can also mention in the description your project that you have done in machine learning. Maybe you will get a chance in machine learning topics. But I would like to say that there are many other fields other than machine learning. Obviously, machine learning is a vibe now. It's going on. But in the industry, if you go and give an interview, they will ask you the basic things. Do you know object oriented? The basic things you need to know. Like, how many of you know AWS here? AWS, you know how to create clouds, you know how to, you know what is AWS Lambda? You know what is platform as a service? You know what is platform as a service, right? Cloud computing. You know what is function as a service? So AWS Lambda is a function as a service, but it is not machine learning. See, there are a lot of other things, wide number of topics other than machine learning, which you can learn. Obviously, you should learn machine learning. I'm not saying you shouldn't. But the thing is that these are the basic things, like REST APIs we'll talk now. You need to understand those kind of things. Machine learning is good. In machine learning, you have to write class-based views, function-based views, which I'm talking. You will obviously have to write some, open up some REST APIs in machine learning also. These are the basic things. You need to learn how to read and write. So if you write a machine learning code, and you have written all class-based function in machine learning. Let's talk machine learning now. Because you all like machine learning. Suppose I don't know machine learning, but you guys know machine learning, so, but you have written the machine learning code. Now you want to open up your machine learning models through REST APIs. Now you don't know REST APIs. How will you open up REST? Without knowing the REST APIs, you open up the machine learning. Obviously, you have to learn my REST APIs. So you know what is REST API? How many of you know what is REST API? What is REST API? So why do we need REST API? You know the Uber architecture? And you have written or have read the Uber architecture. What is microservices? Before the way the company used to develop some software, they used to write the entire architecture in one language, one platform, using Java in one platform. Or you may, in a particular platform, you may write in 2-3 languages. But how do you communicate between 2-3 languages? You need definitely a language which can understand a common medium. So you definitely need REST APIs for communication. Only the software need to understand HTTP. So in Uber, many microservices are written in Go, many are written in Python, many are written in Java. To take any language, I'm not saying you have to write everything in Python. So you have to, you can choose any language, but you need to make some communication between them. So you need to create some REST API for them, for communications. And obviously, each of those languages need to understand HTTP, but right? So the communication happens to HTTP. And what is the value that is transferred? That can be an XML, that can be a JSON, which is transferred between through REST APIs. It is language independent because you can choose any language and create your REST APIs. So we'll be seeing how to implement a REST API using Django REST framework. So till now we have seen what is class-based views, what is model functions. And just similar, with very few lines of code, you can create a REST API. Okay, let's see. So it's a browsable API. I will show you a live. I'll show in my website if I can access from here. What is a REST API? How I have implemented some REST API. I'll show you what is browsable API. Literally, it's just you can browse your REST API through a built-in feature. There are many kinds of authentication available. Now you have written some code in Python, you have written some code in Java. Now you want to make a single authentication. For example, when you log in to a Uber service, they have lot of payment service, gateway service, other kind of service available. But you have login just once, single authentication. So that authentication can be token based, it can be session based. Usually it is token based. There are many kinds of token based authentication available, like just auth o, you can go through it, auth one, the other available. So there is only single authentication which authenticates all the APIs. So there can be some APIs written in Python, some APIs written in Java, and there is single authentication which are handled by the REST APIs. And serialization. So what is serialization? So now your model can talk with the database. So database objects are different, model objects are Python variables. Now if you send your Python to Java, the Java cannot understand. The serializer does is that it takes the model variables and converts into Python objects. It can be a dictionary, it can be a list, anything. Then serializer converts all those variables into JSON format. You can convert your variables into XML format also. Then you send it to other, you can send it to Java platform, you can send it to Go platform, because every platform does understand JSON. So you know what is JSON? You obvious. What is JSON? It's JavaScript object notation. So what is a serializer? It converts your models objects into JSON, converts your JSON object into models, serialize, deserialize, okay. And obviously it's a model serializer, so you are mapping directly to your model. So this is an intern model. And what fields you want to open up to an API? You want to give your intern ID, your name, address and institute. So you have to mention here the fields. The serializer will convert the model instance into JSON format with those APIs. So this is a class based. I'll show you how to do in functions also. Just I'm showing because you have just now learned what is class based APIs, what is GCP. So, but it's a serializer. So when you think of serializer, just think of form APIs. In REST APIs, serializers are just like forms, form APIs, model form API. This is a model form serializer. That's it. These are the two lines to create an API. So this is the class based function. We'll say what which is the model and what. When you write query set instead of model, you can just display the model in different formats. So for example, you want to order by name, you can just write other functions to give a query set in different format. For example, if you want to just get 3 interns out of 100 interns, I want to just give 3 interns at a time through my REST APIs. Well, just you can write other functions in your query sets. So you can also give, instead of writing the query set, you can also write models here. So your models can be is intern, your serializer is the serializer that you have created last. And then you map your serializer to an API. API means the URL name, you can give any name. And the mapping is just the serializer and the or the class and the S view. So that's it. That's just 4 lines of code for creating an API. But I guess it may be hard to understand what is happening internally, but it's just like GCV, generic class based views. So you create a serializer, you create a function, this will be created in view sets. So view sets, why I am calling it view sets, because in basic Django you call it view. So in serializer you can call it view set. So how do you create a serializer? In which, where you will create your, where you will write your APIs? You can write with your Django functions, but that will mess up all the code. So you can create a separate file in each of the models. You can create a separate file called viewset file, viewsets.py, and write all your views, all your viewsets there. For example, this is the viewset, intern viewsets. So it is a model serializer. So it will give all the interns, and so it's connected to the internet, right? should be, no? So I'll just show you how a serializer works. So this is a collaborative community project. So you see, this is the name of our project, is collaboration system. So when you create a project, so it will always create a subfolder with the same project name, which is collaboration system. All others are just apps that you, or modules you have created separately. So in collaborative community, we have a resource called basic article, we have a community app, we have a group app. It's just like Stack Overflow, where, and you can also say it's a group based thing where we have created. So we can, in the user related roles permission, we have kept in user related roles, Ansible, which is another thing. So you see, for basic article, what we have done, so every app will have a models, a view file, and a view sets. In view sets, you will write your APIs. So we have written all our views here, all our models here. Our serializers will come here. You see, this is the serializer I'm talking about. There is only one serializer now, the article serializer. It will give me all the articles. It's only three lines of code. It will say that this model is articles, and the fields ID, title, and body I'm taking. I'm saying that this is the, I want all the articles, and this is my serializer. And if I just open up, so it's giving me all the articles through my APIs. It's giving me the ID, title, and body through my APIs. So now this API is not authenticated. Anyone can access this API because I'm not provided permission classes. Because anyone will access and get all my articles from any part of the world using any language. So how to do permission classes, how to write APIs, we'll see then. But I think you can understand what is API, how to write an API. You basically write your serializer, which will map to the models, and then you will write your view sets, and will open up an API. It will give you all the API in JSON format. Now you can write an AJAX query in jQuery, and you can get all this in forms. Can you see this? So this is where we have included some APIs here. So when we, this is a course module that we have. So every course module will have list of topics, and every topics will have links. So in each of these topics, there are certain resources are there. So we are fetching all those resources through APIs. So these are the resources. So if you click here, it has only one resource. There are three resources. So this API just looks like this. So I'm getting three videos now. So this is the API. So I'm fetching with an ID. I'm getting all the resources. So this is basically a browsable API. So you can create API, this browser, it is built in feature in Django REST framework. And you can fetch all this using AJAX function. So it is written here, course. In course, now you can either create using serializer file here. Now you see there is no serializer and view sets file in this module because I have separated it in the API folder. So You can also either write that way or this way, your APIs. You create another folder API and you create these four files, serializer, curls, and views. So in serializers, you will define all your serializers and view sets, and this is the URL. So you see these URLs and the main URLs are totally different. So it extends the main URL. So you can either declare all your URLs in the main URL UI file, or in every models, every modules, you can define a URL file and you can extend the URL file using import URL. So any question in here? Getting anything, not getting anything? Something, something. थोड़ा थोड़ा हो रहा है ना, थोड़ा थोड़ा होने से भी चलेगा. Okay, then let's not see the rest of the code because it is going very only code. Let's not see what is function, how to write a function. You want to see or don't want to? Don't want to see. Yes, I know that. Okay, because everything is code now. It's going very technical. सब कुछ दिमाग के ऊपर से जा रहा है. I don't want that to be happen. But it's okay. You can come and talk to me anytime, and I'll just explain you what is happening. We'll literally sit and write some code, and many of you will not be doing Django also. Maybe some of you will writing Node.js code. So the thing is going internally similar. So Node.js might not have this internally built-in classes for APIs. So those who want to learn what is Django, there is a resource called Simple is Better than Complex. You can note it down. It starts from very basics. You can also search in your Google what simple is better than complex. It will start from basics and it will explain everything, what is class-based views. It will definitely not explain what is REST APIs, because REST API will not find any resource. After learning GCVV and CVV, you can come to me and I will talk about REST APIs, because REST API is going out of. So basically you just learn these three things, okay, and we'll talk later. One more thing, if you are creating multiple instances of Django in a single machine, so you need to create a virtual environment for that. You install virtual env in your machine and you can run multiple instances of Django. So your models, maybe some Django might be running in another version. You may write multiple versions. For example, the latest version is 2. Something, but in our project we are using 1.11, which is the LTS version. So I prefer LTS. So you should also go for LTS. But they might have changed some syntax in 2.0. So if you want to run multiple instances, you just install the virtual environment, and you will find a lots of documentation for that. Okay, thank you.